We have, we hear our chair is going to be here momentarily, so we just want to officially just wish Shannon a good day to everybody. So, tonight's preview is actually kind of, we do our official rollout, which will be on Thursday at 10 a.m. in Martin Luther King Jr. Library in the Dreamland. And that will be kind of the full presentation, and we'll have a couple of different speakers. We're just really excited to be able to give you a preview of it this evening. But Camp Day Thursday, we will be live streaming it, and we'll also post it on our website as well. So we've got a couple of options. And then, of course, we have a bunch of workshops throughout the application. So, has anybody here applied to the commission in the past? Ms. Gray has? Ms. Brown? Okay. Anybody else? Or is it? We definitely want to make sure you take advantage of our workshops, learn a little bit more, because this is kind of a very quick tour, and then we'll spend much of the weekend. We're just going to have a look at some workshops. How are you doing? Yeah? Okay. Good evening, everybody. My name is Stephen Scott Fatula. I am the Grants Director here at the DC Commission on the Arts and Humanities. Great to have you here. Thank you for joining us. And thanks to Commissioner Jones for putting us all together. I need to speak up?
Yes, wow. Our online folks are.
I don't get that request often, so I'll speak up a little bit. So we've had a lot of changes with the commission, of course, over the past 12 months, but really possibly our biggest and our best change has been our new executive director. So I'm really pleased to introduce Director Arthur Espinosa.
Thank you. Well, good evening. It always surprises me that the front seats never really get filled, so feel free to come on down if you want to see a little bit better, if you don't hear very well, and I'll make sure that people who are tuning in, we have people tuning in?
Yes, we do.
Yes, that they're following us as well. So, welcome. I'm Arthur Espinosa. I'm the Executive Director of the Commission on the Arts and Humanities, and I know there's artists of all ages here, so I'm happy to see it, but especially happy to see your work. Congratulations. We're here to tell you about our grants program, and to tell you about information that you can take with you, and to let you know that we're here to make sure that when you need any service or questions or ways that we can help, that's the other part of what we're here to do. Part of the getting to know each other makes it easy for you to have a face and a name for those that can help you with projects or questions or anything else that you have as you're working on an application. So I'm just curious, who is, by show of hands, intending to submit an application this year? Great, good. Well, I'm happy to see that, and as our commissioner here for Ward 8, Barbara Jones, thank you very much for all your help with this. And she has pointed out to us, we really want to make sure that we get that great representation from all 8 boards. It's really important for us as well. So one of the things that we're going to talk about is the difference between our project grants and some of our other artist fellowship grants, so you'll hear a little bit about that. I won't take up much more of your time, so we can spend more time studying the information. And again, don't forget that if you have questions, we're here to help. I also want to recognize our other commissioner from Ward 8, Edmund Fleet. Welcome. Yes. And I also want to introduce Deputy Director of the Commission on the Arts and Humanities, Michael Bigley, who's right back here. Our staff is here. We're here to help. I'm going to turn it back over to Stephen, and very shortly, the chair of the commission should be arriving, so we'll make a point to introduce her when she's here.
Great. Thank you. So I actually kind of skipped through our agenda. I apologize. So we'll do a welcome, which is just what we did. And then we'll have an overview and look at some recent trends that the agency has been experiencing, talk about some changes that we've made. Then we'll dive into our fellowship and program opportunities for all of you. And then we have time for questions at the end. So feel free to tweet us as we go. I think it's at the DC Arts, hashtag FY17 grants, or we'll take questions at the end. And of course, we have a bunch of workshops that we're about to roll out for all of you. So just looking ahead, our chair is on her way, and so we'll go back to her slides when she gets here. Looking at some recent trends, so as you can see in FY15, we had 663 applications. We convened 26 panels. Panels we'll talk about a little bit later, but they're groups of 8 to 10 of your peers. They represent a diversity in disciplines, a diversity in board representation, a diversity in arts administration experience. In FY16, that number rose to 788 applications, and we had 31 panels. Last summer, we had over 250 volunteer panelists looking at our applications. It was a demanding period for us, but a really great one at the same time. So in addition to thinking about applying, we really encourage you to think about being a panelist. It's a great way to learn about how our panels are received, see how our panels are run, and take part in some of the outcomes affecting your community. So really think about that. But it's a lot of paperwork and a lot of applications. So what we really did was try to take a look at our efficacy and streamline so that we would have some deeper impact within our community. So one of our responses, in addition to some program changes that we've done, was to split our cycle. So what we did in the winter is that we received applications from historic arts, education, and humanities organizations and took care of them. So now what our concentration are is on our individuals and our community program providers. So not necessarily arts in our theaters or museums or poetry spaces, but looking at our community providers, and we're turning our attention now to all of you. Helps us do a deeper dive with all of your applications and serve you better, and it helps us to make sure that we're being clear and not dealing with 600 applications all at the same time, but to split them into two cycles. So that's that was part one and part two. So what we're here to talk about today is what we're calling our fellowship and our grant and our project application cycle. So here to talk us through our possibilities for individuals, this is my colleague, Reagan Sperla.
So we do have a couple of opportunities for individuals who are residents of the District of Columbia, and before we talk about what those opportunities are, we'll just let you know some of the other eligibility requirements. So DC residency, for some programs it's 1 year, for some programs it's 2 years. Check those guidelines to find out which is the one you're looking at. All applicants have to be over the age of 18. I'm so sorry. You must be in good standing with the city as well as with our agency. So if you've received grant funds in the past, just check in with your program officer to make sure that your paperwork has been taken care of. And you'll need to complete a couple of compliance documents, and that's how we'll find out if you're in good standing with the District of Columbia. And more details about all of those, of course, in our guidelines.
Okay, great. So we have great addition to our panel today. It's my pleasure to introduce our chair. This is Kate Campbell. Say a quick hello.
No? Well, I do want to say hello. I'm sorry. I'm just walking in now. I got stuck in some traffic, and I don't know what's already been said. I'd like to add anything to it, but first I want to just be here and listen to the presentation that's been prepared and just be part of the team. So I'm glad you all turned out tonight to hear.
So our three opportunities for individual applicants are Arts and Humanities Fellowship Program. These are general operating grants for individuals for artists of all disciplines. Our Festival Projects, Events, and Festivals Grants. These are project-based grants. So individuals may apply to do a project that impacts DC residents through the Arts and Humanities. And then our Public Art Building Communities Grant. Individuals are also eligible to apply for. These pesky compliance documents that I just mentioned, we actually have a handout.
A fun takeaway
that we'll make available at the end of this presentation that breaks down all of the compliance requirements for all of our grant programs. So I won't go into detail now, but I'm happy to answer any questions you have about any of these materials. So our Arts and Humanities Fellowship Program, this is our most popular opportunity for individual applicants. This is the non-project general operating opportunity for individuals of all artistic disciplines. Support for individuals creating exemplary work in the arts and humanities. The deadline will be May 20th at 4 p.m. through our online grants portal. And new to the Arts and Humanities Fellowship Program this year is that teaching artists will be eligible to apply. The next opportunity for individuals is the Projects, Events, and Festivals Grant. These, again, are for individuals to execute projects in the arts and humanities that impact DC residents. For this one, it is unlike the fellowship, it's a project grant, so you're applying for with a specific budget and marketing materials and a very specific timeline, and you may apply for up to $10,000. The deadline for this is May 26th, again at 4 p.m. New to this grant program this year, in addition to the name, this formerly was called City Art Project, so if anyone knew this grant in past years, it is now called Projects, Events, and Festivals. Individuals must provide insurance or plan to acquire insurance to cover their event. Additionally, Projects, Events, and Festivals now includes projects that work with the sister cities of the District of Columbia. This had been a separate grant program, but now it is included in this grant program. And the last opportunity for individuals is public art building communities. Grant manager for this program wasn't able to come out tonight. Her name is Kiana Pearson. So if you have questions about temporary or permanent public art installations that you're thinking of, she's the person to direct those to. These grants are up to $50,000, and the deadline will be July 11th.
Thank you.
And I'll turn it back over to Stephen to talk about organizations.
So for our organizations, of course, we are looking at organizations who have that 501c3 tax-exempt status at the time of application. Organizations that are headquartered and incorporated in D.C., we do not accept P.O. boxes. The D.C. Treasurer will not write a check to a P.O. box. There has to be a land address within the District of Columbia. Good standing with D.C. and the Arts Commission and some of those things that Reagan touched upon. We received requests for compliance documents from the Office of Partnerships and Grant Services, things like an arrest and conviction statement, a statement of certification. These are all going to be new for you, especially if you apply for us. They're new for us as well. What's great is that they're all available on our website, and they're really easy to get a hold, download, and include. So our organizations that are open for projects include our arts education, East of the River, facilities and buildings, projects, events, and festivals, public art building communities, and our Upstart program. This is that sort of pesky kind of document tracker. This is why we have it in a takeaway form for you. Also makes a pretty good bookmark. But this way you'll be able to find out the program, its deadline, and what documents are required. So don't worry about scrambling with these slides. We know that they're really a little overwhelming. They're overwhelming for us. But that's why this takeaway, and of course our applications and our program guidelines are available on our website and at all of our workshops. So this is just sort of for you to play at home. Let's see, now two slides. So I'll begin first by talking about our arts education project. There's a new component, but really the best new component is our new arts education associate program manager. So it's my privilege to introduce LaShawn Bryans. So this is LaShawn's second day on the job, so we didn't want to put
What are you waiting for?
But she'll be working with our program manager, David Markey, and talking about the great opportunity to come to workshops. LaShawn was a former applicant to the commission, so she really has experience with working with our portal from the other side, and we're really excited to be working with her. So do you want to have any comments about day two on the job?
It's amazing. And I love that my job is just to ask people what it is they want to do. What's your dream, and how can I help you get there? So let's get much better than that.
Get to know. So the second, which will probably be equally as exciting, is that we used to formally require the Cultural Data Project, which was a form that we do with connection with the Pew Charitable Trust. It's a way to track programmatic information, accounting, et cetera, et cetera. We found that that really wasn't a great fit for the Arts Education Project program, so we've removed it. So if you're working with one of our charter schools or working with that always kind of wrestled with that report, we took it away from you this year. It should be a little bit easier to complete that application. So our next program that we're going to talk about today is our East of the River program. Also has a really exciting new component to it. and that is our new East of the River Program Manager. So please join me welcoming Colleen Randall.
This program is going to be really an incredible program, but I say that in a general way, that it's the only program out of all six there that is more exclusive to awards 7 and 8. So not everyone can apply for that. You need to either have services in ward 7 or 8 or have a facility in ward 7 or 8. So I would say take advantage of that opportunity, because you're leaving out another six wards that can apply for that. Up to $20,000 in funds. The deadline is May 25th that we have. We also have three different workshops. So if you need some support on how and what you're looking to do, attend one of the workshops, find me afterwards, get my business card, and I'll definitely try to support and do everything I can to help you build that successful application. I'm going to talk about that also in another slide. So that'll be it for this one here. Oh, and I will say that the awesome thing is that data arts, cultural pieces, data part is not a part of the application any longer. And that was a laborious task to try to put together.
Cool. This is Colleen's second week, so he got to speak a little longer. Yeah, so we're really excited to work with him. And we'll all be here afterwards if you have any questions about any of the stuff we just touched on. So moving on a little bit forward, we have our Facilities and Buildings program. This will also be managed by Colleen. It's up to $200,000 for things, acquisition of a space that you have occupied for 5 years and plan on staying in for at least 10, that is exclusively for arts, humanities, or arts education activities. But also if you have a facility that has a Marley dance floor that needs refinishing, or permanent fixtures for exhibition of future great works of visual art, that's for our facilities and buildings. So if you're thinking of, it's really everything that can't be taken out. So if you have any questions about this program, feel free to forward that to Colleen or to me. But that's how we look at facilities and buildings. So it wouldn't necessarily be for the lighting instruments for your theater, but it would be for the wiring, and it would be for the rigging that is permanently affixed to your space. That's just kind of a little bit, but we can get into greater detail down the road. Projects, events, and festivals. We touched on a little bit with rating, so I won't spend too much time here. It has a maximum of $20,000. Support for sister cities is now included. We're very committed to our relationship with our 14 sister cities. We just felt it was a good fit within this program. Projects will be reviewed in cohorts based on an organization's cash expenses, not based on project cash expenses. We use cohorts because we want to make sure our panelists read no more than 35 applications at a time. So how we organize them is based on an organization's cash size. The expression that I like to use, that most people don't like to use, is that we don't want to be comparing apples to cranberries, but still understand that they're both fruit. And so that's kind of how we use this cohort system, make sure we're managing. Public art building, yes, sir.
Sorry.
No, that's great.
We can ask questions.
Whatever you want.
Okay,
yeah, yeah. It's informal.
Maybe you already defined what sister cities are.
Sure.
Maybe I missed that already.
The District of Columbia has 14 cities throughout the world that they have declared sister cities. And so they include Addis Ababa, Ankara, Bangkok, Rome, Paris. But they have that designation. So if you have a program involving one of those 14, then that would be considered as eligible for sister city support. Do you want to talk about Tishwani? Tishwani?
Sure, that's
another.
I'll give you an example.
Sure.
An example of a past sister cities project is the organization Slopus Rock sent a delegation of poets. An organization in the district who has received that grant in the past year brought a delegation of poets who are DC residents to Tshwane, South Africa, to do workshops and performances there, and then followed up a couple of months later and brought poets from there to Washington, D.C. to do workshops and performances here.
Sure.
So a cultural exchange.
Can we find a bit with the sister city there?
Yep. It's in the, I believe it's in the guidelines.
It's in the guidelines. It's also on the Office of the Secretary of the District of Columbia's website. So their main website. They have all of their agreements posted with each of the cities.
Great, thank you. We'd love to designate our favorites, but it's not up to us to designate. They've already been designated. Public arts building communities for organizations. The maximum grant is $100,000. These are temporary or permanent art installations in our neighborhoods. So that canoe right here, right near the Anacostia Art Center, would be an example of public art building communities, that type of installation. The Upstart is our capacity building program. It's for organizations that receive additional support through consultants that work in participation with the commission. It's a bit involved, so workshops for Upstart are mandatory. And also new for us is going to be an interview process. So we understand that a terrific application can sometimes be a reflection of a terrific project or a terrific organization. Sometimes it can just be a really terrifically written application. With the intensity of the Upstart program in terms of the relationship with leadership and staff, we really want to make sure that we're receiving the right fit. So after the first round, the top 12 finalists will be invited to come in and just talk about your organization with the consultants, with the commission, to make sure that it's the right fit. So if you're new to the commission, well, if you're thinking about Upstart, you have to come to a workshop because it's really involved. It's a great program. We're really excited about it, but it's a bit more involved. So just kind of an overview, you have that great takeaway. You can see our deadlines begin on May 18th with Arts Education, and they wrap up just before Memorial Day with Upstart. We have our panels in July and August, and then we make our announcements on October 3rd. That's kind of our schedule for FY17, our final awards. This has been a whirlwind tour through the grants process and program. We really encourage you to take a look at when our workshops are. I'll be right there in a second. So, make sure you're aware and come to our workshops. Each is program specific. You have an opportunity to work with the program manager, learn about the criteria for each program. It's a really deep dive into all of them. We'll be doing 21 of them. Some will be at our headquarters over in Navy Yard. We're really excited that we're also branching out into libraries. We'll be at Benning Road and Mount Pleasant this year. And we're also excited that we have two workshops that will be interpreted into American Sign Language as well. That's new for us this year as we're taking it.
Great. I just wanted to add one thing, and that is that I've heard from a lot of Ward 8 residents that are concerned about how we are being inclusive. And I wanted to just share with you one of the things that's really important to us at the Commission, and that is our ideals of inclusivity. We want to make sure that this is wide-reaching in all the opportunities that we provide. We want to make sure that there's a good amount of diversity in the kind of programs that we're funding, and we also want to make sure that we make programs that we're providing as accessible as possible. So we've actually kind of put this all together in a nice little acronym, which is really city-like for us to do because everything has an acronym. And so if you'll remember the acronym IDEA, it stands for Inclusion, Diversity, Equity, and Access. And that's the way that we're approaching all the programs. It's what we've brought in since I took this position as a person coming in and saying, what did I experience on the outside when I was applying for grants? Because I've been on that side as well. And what did I feel was missing? And so those are things that I've been taking in and putting into play in this role that I have as director now. But I'm also a person who likes to listen. So if you have ideas or you have suggestions, we want to hear those, and we're going to decide when we can maybe be able to implement some of those ideas. Sometimes really good ideas come from people right here that have worked through this or have questions or thoughts about how things can be done better. So I just wanted to make sure that you knew that that's exactly what the staff expects of, that what I expect of the staff is that they're going to be there and they're going to be listening and supporting and serving the community, which is you, all right? So I'm hopeful that this information sheet that we've provided gives you a lot of the good details. You can see it's pretty clearly laid out. If you're an individual and you're looking for funding, your organization, if you have ideas, and if you have questions, don't hesitate to contact the staff at any time. We're more than happy to help. But officially,
on we go.
We'll go on.
So I think it was workshop. Oh, Mr. Green, you had a question?
Yeah, the question. Would you mention the date of announcing the grant?
Yep.
What date is that?
October 3rd.
And for FY17?
For FY17, that's the beginning of our fiscal year.
I think he means this Thursday. Grant, are you speaking
of... Oh, sorry. If you're talking about the rollout of the applications...
When you can start applying?
When it starts applying?
No, not when I apply in May.
Right.
If I'm awarded a grant, when do I get the information that I'm actually being awarded?
October 3rd.
October 3rd, begin on October the 1st.
Well, October the 1st is a Saturday this year.
No, but I understand. But that's when the program begins. How about to be in that? How about to receive information of receiving a grant when the date of, you know, it doesn't make
Are
sense.
Are you talking about an event that you're looking to apply for that it begins
I'm
that apply, day?
No, I'm applying for activity that's going to take place from October 1 of 2017 through, I mean, 2016, I'm sorry. Through September 30th, 2017. And let's assume that what I want to do is in October, but I only get information that says I'm being funded October. It doesn't make sense to me. You understand what I'm saying?
I do.
Yeah.
No, it's,
you happen to be very close to that line. Most people would have a little bit of distance, but we'll at least advise in advance as soon as we know information about who we intend to fund. We try to provide that information as soon as all of our grants panels have been completed. And we've made decisions about how that the money will be distributed, then we start to provide a letter to give you that information in advance. But the funds actually aren't...
No, I'm
aren't
clear about
when
the funds... No, I'm clear on that. The question's about being
so the,
informed.
So there's a letter of intent to fund.
Yeah.
Right. It's probably
when
am
I
going
to be informed? If I'm able to be awarded a grant,
right.
When am I going to be informed about being awarded a grant?
Traditionally, it's been October the 1st of the fiscal year. Usually it's been the first of this year. So we have a new administration. There might be some new changes. Again, that information out fast.
Well,
but traditionally it's been the first of
the doesn't
week.
Make sense.
Yeah.
I mean, it just doesn't.
Yeah.
Noted.
I mean, you have to start at some time. I mean,
yeah,
there's no perfect day to start.
Exactly. So
right
cycle. I think you,
so
if your project, for instance, were fully dependent on the funding, that's obviously going to be something that we just have to wait until you get that notification. We certainly want to make sure that we can get the information to you as soon as possible. And so that's something that we'll take into consideration as to how we notify. Good question. You had a question?
Yes. How long do we have to deliver a grant if we are selected? Do we have to act within the end of the month?
Some of the grants don't have anything. Does that mean that individuals and organizations can apply to those grants, or what does that mean?
Which one doesn't have anything?
Our
organization.
East of the River is only for organizations.
So just at the very top, you see that this bank over on this side is organizations.
Okay.
Also, and so that side is individuals.
So
some
the
of the programs. Yeah. So some of the programs are applicable to an individual or to an organization, and some are organization only.
Okay. Yeah. And my first question. About projects.
So can you apply for two different projects as an individual? Is that what your question?
Two different grants as in like a project grant and also the fellowship grant. I'm just curious.
You can apply for a fellowship and a project.
Oh, okay.
Yes. And actually PABC for individuals. Public art building communities for individuals.
Right.
Yeah.
You may submit one application for each.
Oh, okay. For each
of
those.
And that's a good technicality, is that if you do have separate projects, you don't want to lump them all as one, because then it would just be under one application.
Mm-hmm.
If it really fits under a fellowship program, you want to be applying for that unique program, then you want to apply for public art building communities, and then you want to apply for a project, if you have a project, an event, or a festival.
Can you be funded for more than one?
Yep. Let's hope, right?
Okay. Yeah, no problems. Okay. Then we have a quick. So I touched on this very briefly about the role of panelists in looking at our applications. I thought Khalid could speak to this a little bit more because he was a panelist for us last summer, loved it so much that now he works for us. So what better advertisements would that be?
First question I do have is, how many people have applied for the position for funding? And one. How many people have applied and successfully won a grant? One, two. All right, the reason I asked those two questions, it was so helpful to be on that panel. One, you're at the table, you understand your competition, that's across all boards. And so I came to that table thinking you come sometimes in your own little box. And so when I start to see the other organizations that have submitted an application, that's extremely, extremely helpful. That's the first thing. Number two, it gives you the ability to understand how they're scoring your application. So when you submit an application, you're thinking, I'm the best writer in the world, I'm running, and I have the best service, and I'm not doubting that. But sometimes it can go down and written down in a different way. So being at that table, you understand, one, what they're looking for as panelists, they come from all different kinds of, you will build a successful application, even if you can't fund everyone, but even if you didn't win this time around, that means that second opportunity is a strong opportunity that when you understand, they're looking for this criteria, I also know I'm competing against X, and I'm going to have this. So see one of the staff members afterwards, and it's a small commitment too. You review applications, and you spend one day at the commission, not five. So it's not a lot of what we're asking, but the what you're going to get on that backside of it is truly, truly invaluable. So see any of the staff members, we'll take your information, serve on a panel one day. I can guarantee you you're going to have a better application, whether it's to the commission or to someone else. But truly, see us and serve on that panel.
Say it's just as impactful as jury duty, but a lot more fun. Yes, ma'am.
You get food.
Brother, we don't talk about that.
Would our participation in the panel exclude us for
a client? You can definitely be a panelist on one panel. You just can't be on a panel for a program that you've applied for.
Oh, okay.
But as you saw, we're expecting to have 21 panels this summer, so we'll have lots of opportunities to have your serve. So, yep. Okay, so we're in the home stretch. Just some tips and tricks that we, as grant managers who've been in the system for a while, recommend. Really, make sure you're on a listserv so you can find out about events like this. We have a Facebook page, follow us on Twitter. Just keep up to date with information that we're new workshops, changing in locations. Sometimes we may add a workshop. So just make sure you're connected with us there. I always advise people, even though our deadlines say 4 p.m., really think that it's 12 noon. This way, if you run into an issue, there's time. Of course, we're going to answer your call. We're going to provide as much service as we can, but we tend to get a lot of calls between 3:45 and 4:10. And we will get back to you. We just think, if you think about it 12 noon, chances if you run into an issue, we'll be able to respond that much more. Get those required insurance, those documents that we have that are required, do them first. You're going to spend a lot of time working on your application, which is really the heart of the matter. So you don't want to be thrown at the last minute, oh, I don't have my certificate of insurance, oh, I needed to get my W-9 together. Just pull all of that stuff. It's available on our website. We're happy to have you come down to our office, and we'll print out a copy for you as well. Just get those boxes checked as soon as possible. Please try and save your documents as a PDF. Everything we do is online. And when you save it as a PDF, when a panelist looks at it, it doesn't download to their hard drive. It makes it a lot easier for them to work with. So again, just kind of a tip. Attend our workshops for the program. It's really important to get into the specific criteria for East of the River versus the criteria for the fellowship program. Get to know your program managers. We're here tonight. We're happy to help meet with you, look at drafts of your applications a week before the deadline, as available. But begin a dialogue. We want to be able to speak, advocate for you with as much knowledge about what you're doing as possible. And then familiarize yourself with the program's guidelines and portal, especially if it's your first time. Make sure you look at those. I believe most, if not all, of our application guidelines and questions, even though the application portal doesn't open until Thursday, you can start reading over stuff now. Start giving us emails with clarification right now, and we're happy to work with you as soon as possible. And I think that may be, oh, of course, we want to thank all of our partners in tonight's event. This is a long list, but it includes terrific people that some of whom were here tonight and some of whom were helpful in getting us all together. So we really want to thank our Board 8 partners for this evening. And I can go back to this. And now we touched on some of your questions, but do you have other questions that you are still working on or thinking about? Yes, ma'am.
You said that you can meet with program managers to review your application up until a week before the deadline?
Yes. Yeah, so you just connect and find out their availability, but we're happy to sit down, look at the draft of your application, give you some feedback.
Okay.
Up until a week before the deadline. Any other questions? Yes?
I couldn't skip this. I came in late.
That's okay.
Does each business or individual nonprofit have to be established in D.C.?
Has to be headquartered and located in D.C. Individuals have to reside in D.C.
Maybe asking not too far of a question.
No such thing.
Data arts.
Then you're asking the right person.
What's the data arts report?
What's the data?
Data arts report.
Oh, data arts report. Okay. So the Pew Charitable Trust established a nationwide way of tracking arts and humanities organizations' fundraising, accounting, performances, and it streamlined it so that every arts organization could have one report. And it's a great way to track different growth and trends across organizations in similar cities, in similar disciplines, but it's a very time-consuming report. And you really need to make sure that you have a couple of years of information to complete the report. So a lot of our community program providers have trouble figuring out a way to address what their community programs were within their arts programs. And so the report, the data in that report, was really not very impactful. So we decided as an agency that we would restrict, we relied really heavily on that report, but we would use it for our Upstart program, which is for capacity, but is also limited to arts and humanities organizations, for facilities, where we want to make sure an organization could sustain a relatively expensive, so we've limited it to those programs. For East of the River, for arts education, for projects, events, and festivals, where we may be working with churches, synagogues, historic main streets, we decided that the data arts report wasn't quite as helpful, and so that's why it was taken away there.
Great question.
Any other questions? Yes, sir.
So you mentioned being more inclusive of artists, East of the River, 478. Historically, not historically, but you can talk about historically, has there been less representation or from people or organizations or that get grants from, I mean, I'm just trying to get a better sense of
yeah.
why that.
Well, I think it's both people who apply is also less. So one of the things is we want to make sure that everybody knows how to do that, and our applications in Ward 7 and 8 tend to be lower. There's also fewer organizations that are providing arts and humanities services or programming within Ward 7. So just the numbers overall are lower. And then as a result, then the grants that are made are lower as well. So what we're trying to do is say, what can we do to make sure that we're giving as much opportunity and providing as much information so that we can be sure that people are increasing, that number is increasing overall. Other questions? Was this helpful?
Yeah.
Well, that's all right. we know about traffic problems and things like that. So,
what is the arrest and conviction statement?
It's just a document from the Office of Partnerships and Grant Services. It has no impact on your application when it's being reviewed. It's just a document that is to ensure compliance with procedures citywide. So it is not
panelists
something.
Will not see
panelists it. Will not see it. We just make sure that it's there, and that's it's just a document for.
I
see that's required for everybody.
And
what if it's a first business? They just
thought. They should also be able to have an employer identification number,
yeah,
which would
okay,
provide
yeah.
that. So it's the same thing.
Yeah. Okay.
That just would go on a W-9 form.
All right. Our organization is able to apply for more than one of the grants under the liberal arts education, or are they just limited to one?
They're limited to two,
okay.
And one in each program.
Okay.
So you could do arts education and East of the River and projects, events, and festivals, but you would not be able to submit two East of the River applications. One per program, but a maximum of two.
And you can't be a panelist on the application that you want to apply
for. Correct. So if you're applying for a specific grant program, you can't be a panelist on that grant program.
So what if I'm applying for a project, events, festival on this side as an individual, but I want to be a panelist for project, events, festival on the organization side? Is that different?
Yeah, if you're applying as an individual, you could then sit on the panel for organizations.
Yeah, just follow that column down. If that's the column that you're applying for, you can't be on a panel in that program.
Our organizations.
Oh, sorry.
I'm sorry.
I know you had your hand up, so I was going to get back to you.
Two questions. So what does your workshop consist of? And also, since I won't be eligible for 2017, since I just moved to D.C., I'll be eligible for 2018. Would you recommend me going to these workshops just to kind of, just grasp exactly what you guys are doing? And
absolutely. I think there's a lot of good information. But I'd like to talk with you after about your eligibility.
Okay.
Because if you've just moved here, we need to look and see if there's really alignment there or not.
Okay.
So we'd be happy to talk with you about that.
And I would really consider being on the panel. Okay. That would help you aren't eligible now for when you are.
Oh. And the workshops are there, and there are a lot of information, whether it's even for us or otherwise, it's going to be very valuable for you to find something in it that you can take away.
Can I just say something about being a panelist? So I've served on three different panels, never applied for a grant before, and after reviewing panels and seeing so many of my other friends get grants, it really sort of helped my confidence to apply this year. So I would strongly encourage people to be a panelist. It was a great experience. It is a lot of work sometimes. I don't know what panel you sat on, but some of the panels I sat on were definitely pretty time intensive, but it was definitely well worth it. So I just second that.
Well, thank you.
Well, that's great. We're going to find a quote from you for later. But I will say one of the things that we've been trying to work on is reducing the amount of applications. And it's always tough to know because we get so many, which is great. There's a lot of people who want to be able to have access and who put in good proposals, but it does take time to sort through all those.
And just to answer your question, what actually happens at the workshop? So each of these programs has different criteria. So for projects, events, and festivals, the budget criteria is different from how it may be in a facilities and buildings application and what we mean by. So it really spends time going into what do we mean impact for Ward 7 and 8 communities. How do we assess that? So it really gets into the nitty-gritty of each application, each of those documents that are required for the application. What do we mean by uploading resumes? Whose resume? Should it be a bio or a CV? Or should it be me or one of my teaching artists or one of my board members? We sort of unpack for each application. And then there's another Q&A period, much like this one, but pertaining to that program specifically. They're each about 45 minutes to 90, 45 to 90 minutes. Depending on the Q&A. Any other questions, maybe?
Oh, yes. What qualifications are you looking for individuals to serve on the panel?
Well, why don't you go ahead and address that?
So we look for people who have an investment in the arts and humanities and communities of Washington. We look for representation in arts and humanities background, arts education background, but also representation from all eight wards. We're looking for diversity of life experiences and looking for people who might bring fresh perspectives to how programs might impact their communities. So I like to say it's each panel's a diamond with many facets. We want to make sure that we have a multiplicity of disciplines represented, but all eight wards represented, so it's kind of a little bit of alchemy. But I think that's what it works.
So you have to be a DC resident?
No, you don't have to be a DC resident. No. Any other questions? We're going to be hanging out and putting chairs away and stuff like that. So if you have additional questions, feel free to come up and introduce yourselves. So hopefully we'll see some of you Thursday morning. when we do this all over again in the Dream Lab at MLK Library. But if not, hopefully we'll see you at all our workshops. And thank you.
Thank you all for coming.
Yeah, really.